Reading from the New King James Version, Ephesians 5, 15 to 21. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation. But be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another in the fear of God. Let's pray. Father God, I just thank you. Thank you so much for every word, every inspired word that's in our Bible. I thank you that we can own one freely. I thank you that we can bless those that don't have one. Lord, as we open up this study, as we open up a new year, I just ask for you to work in the room through your Holy Spirit. Just bring people closer to you today, Lord Jesus. Change their hearts, and may every word be redeeming in your sight. Amen. Amen. All right, let's test our very short-term memories. I'm not even sure this qualifies as short-term memories. Let's go back 10 days, 10 days ago on what we were all doing, regardless of location. Were we celebrating the arrival of this new year, 2016, with friends, with family? Were we at larger gatherings, perhaps? Or were we alone with our own thoughts? Regardless of how, it's pretty much assured that all of us were united in the what. That is, saying goodbye to the old year and hello to the new year with anticipation. We anticipate the new year with much zeal and fanfare, even counting down each second before midnight. Why? For many, the dawning of a new year represents an opportunity to reflect on the great events of the last year. Birth of babies, perhaps, marriages, graduations, new jobs, life adventures, a joyous remembrance of the year that was. For some, it's a welcome goodbye to the year before and its challenges, its heartbreak, its loss, its fear, disappointments. And instead to say hello to the newness of a fresh start, a blank canvas, a clean slate. Many use the turning over of the calendar as an opportunity to make New Year's resolutions, pledges of a sort, made mainly with ourselves and mainly about ourselves. We make goals for the new year. We resolve to go to bed earlier, maybe watch less TV, maybe spend less time on social media. Maybe spend more time with friends and family. Maybe we decide to eat better and spend more time in the gym, working out. God's got a sense of humor. Anybody that denies that can just look at my robust figure. And I have this on hanging on my door today as I'm about to preach this message. I'm not going to endorse this establishment because I don't know them from the hills, but it's the claims to be the world's largest 24-hour gym and co-ed fitness center chain. Excellent. Like I need to work out 24/7. Maybe I do. Why do these always come out at New Year's? Right? Why do fitness equipment ads run supreme right around this time of year? Right? It's because we are resolving in our flesh to do something different. We've identified a need. We've identified somewhere where we're falling short of our own expectation. And we are the ones committing to ourselves to make changes. If we're the ones in control of all of this, let me ask you, why do New Year's resolutions so often fail? They fail because we are using our intellect alone to make these choices. And we are standing in our own strength to succeed. That's a pretty tenuous combination. Not only are we leading ourselves, we're standing in our own strength. Well, today what I want to delve into with you is a different approach, a godly approach. It's an approach centered around the start of a new year but also centered around the words of 2 Corinthians 5:17, which tells us that when we are in Christ, we are what? We are a new creation. I want us to go ahead and make new life resolutions rather than New Year's resolutions. Seeking the Lord before we make any changes, following the leading of the Holy Spirit, and relying on His strength rather than ours. I can only imagine, and God assures us, that it's a much better combination. In fact, it's more than that. It's a holy and powerful combination. Certainly stands more chance of success than me standing in my own strength. And I challenge you to think about it that way too. It's also in stark contrast to the world's typical approach on December 31st. These new life resolutions aren't about us. Let me repeat that. These new life resolutions aren't about us. They are about Him. They're about Him being at the center of our lives. In our passage from Ephesians today, we are going to be challenged to align our new life, the life He's given us, the life we have in Him, aligning that to His plan, and to wisely deploying our time, talents, and treasures, the gifts that He has given us, to glorify Him. We do this not from a position of guilt. So many have misstepped. We do this from a position of worship, from a position of thankfulness, in recognition of what He has done in our lives. We will see the joy that comes from aligning our new life, if you will, resolving to embrace our new life, the life that God has given us, the one that He wants for us, and the life that has been washed clean of our sins through the blood of Jesus. But how do we do this? For you note takers, here's your short summary. The Bible passage today is going to give us a robust blueprint, I hope, which involves walking circumspectly with wisdom. We'll dive into the definitions of some of those words. 2, redeeming our time in these evil days. And 3, maintaining self-control. Let me repeat that. Today in this passage, we're going to look through walking circumspectly with wisdom. 2, redeeming our time in these evil days. And finally, maintaining our self-control, which we will also see results in 3 things: singing and encouragement, 2, thankfulness, and 3, submission. I'll repeat those for those that are scribbling frantically. It results in singing and encouragement, thankfulness, and submission. For those that just finished scribbling all that down and like a title, I've entitled this teaching New Life Resolutions versus New Year's Resolutions. Okay, let's dig in. Verse 15, we are told to walk circumspectly. The message here is twofold. First, we are told to walk. We are told to move forward, not to stand still in our lives and in our walk with the Lord. Are you moving forward? Growing, learning, praying, serving, or are you standing still? That's between you and the Lord, and I just ask that you pray that prayer and ask Him to tell you where you're at. So that's the what. Walk. Then we're told how to move forward, circumspectly and with wisdom. This will take a little longer. Circumspectly, the Greek word is akribos, which has its root in the Greek word akribēs, which is translated, get this, as the most straightest. Interesting. How many of us fit that quality? Exactly none of us. Although I love all of you, none of us are Jesus. Right? So I don't want you to feel guilty. This is not a guilt trip sermon. This is an encouragement sermon, because the only most straightest is the one that did it all. We are being told in other translations that the word is careful, diligent, We are being told to be careful with our actions, our thoughts, our words, and our choices, to ensure that our witness and testimony remain intact. Like any valuable gift that we're given, we're being asked to respect it and carefully protect it in order that, why? That the maximum benefit for His glory is preserved. It's not about us. It takes wisdom to do this. And that wisdom comes from where? Here? 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 No, it can only come from above. We can point to many in the Bible who were wise, but flawed. People like Solomon, who was gifted with the most wisdom in history. Moses, who led the nation out of Egypt after negotiating the release. Joshua, who led the nation of Israel into the promised land and followed God's leading. We also see in our Bible many kings and judges who were complete fools, thumbing their nose at every turn at God. And then we see many that probably are more like us. We're foolish from time to time. But these people, just like us, are ultimately redeemed. Like Aaron with the golden calf. How about Samson with Delilah? David? Any guesses? How about Bathsheba? What about Peter? St. Peter denies the Lord three times when he needs to stand strong. They've been foolish. They've also been redeemed. And that's the message today. What's the difference between those who are wise and those who are foolish? How can we be wise and not foolish? Let's spend a couple minutes digging into that. Well, here's my thought. Fools follow the desires of their heart, their flesh. What resonated for me was 1 John 2:16 and 17. I've got the ESV in front of me here. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and pride in possessions is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires. That says it all right there. Fools are self-centered. They seek the approval of man. They're gauging others through the lens of what those people can do for them. And they are focused on the here and now and not eternity. Secondly, fools kill time. Time spent on deeds which are based on their own strength, just like a New Year's resolution, and their own righteousness. Righteousness that Isaiah 64:6 refers to as like filthy rags, dirty, unclean, absolutely no eternal value. Conversely, wise people invest their time for eternal purposes and for an eternal return. They live with Matthew 6:19-21 in mind, which unequivocally defines the difference between laying up your treasures on earth, here on earth, where they are destined, it says, to be destroyed or stolen, versus the huge benefit of laying up your treasures in heaven, where it says, again, that they will be protected for eternity. Further, fools live in a way that when put to the test of Matthew 6, where we are told where your treasure is, there your heart will be also, they fail. They need to be aware that their treasures need to be in the eternal for their heart to be in the right position. So let me challenge you. Here's an application. In your quiet time with the Lord this week, ask Him to reveal where your treasure is. Is it in the world or is it in heaven? For that's where your heart is at too. If your heart is focused on the eternal, then be encouraged. You are more than likely living in alignment wisely with our passage today. And you're living for His glory. However, if He reveals to you that your treasures and your heart have drifted off of true north, the most straightest, a new life lived for Him, then also be encouraged. Again, no guilt here. Be encouraged. because real life changes can be made and through with him and through him, not with or through a New Year's resolution. If your heart-o-meter test, there's an official term, you can write it down, I'm sure it'll be quoted many times, the heart-o-meter test, isn't coming up all roses, then I'm going to challenge you again to look at your lives. Look critically. Be honest with yourself on how you're deploying your time, your talents, and your treasures. Are you killing time on earthly, selfish pursuits, which the Lord told Isaiah are equivalent to those filthy rags? Things that we want. We want today, we want this week, we want this month, we want this year. Things we want. Or, by contrast, are you living with wisdom? And by the words of verse 16 here today, are you redeeming your time? Are you investing time, obeying him, following his outline for your life, and committing to activities, prayer, study, fellowship, worship, service, that are redeeming to him, in turn bringing you more eternal treasure? And also filling your new life here on earth with more joy, more faith, more truth, certainly more hope, and definitely more peace. God redeemed us in his time, according to his plan. He didn't do it on our time, and it certainly didn't fit our plans. It's transactional. Let's focus on that. It's transactional. It's like when you redeem a gift certificate. Coming out of Christmas, we've all got gift cards, I'm sure. Praise the Lord for that. But this is like the biggest gift certificate in history. It's an amazing story of love, grace, and mercy. He redeemed a gift certificate which said, redeem one perfect lamb for the salvation of all souls. Amen. He traded his perfect son, committing him to a hideous death on a cross for us. What are we doing to redeem the time that Jesus just bought for us? This new life, washed clean in his eyes. What aren't we doing? What are we doing that has no redeeming quality? This, my fools, I mean friends, is what we need. We need his wisdom to discern, and then we need his help to accomplish. Although we might be able to affect some temporary earthly changes through a New Year's Eve resolution, these pledges made in our own strength, aren't we better served to allow him to change us from the inside out by fully submitting to his will, embracing the new life that he bought for us from that cross? He literally bought us an eternity of time with him. God doesn't want us to disrespect his gift. He wants us to be careful with it and committing our lives and our time on earth as his ambassadors. Let's figure out what he wants. And let's do it. Why now? Passage here says today, because the days are evil. Then and now, then in Ephesus, a city racked with sexual sin, false gods, idolatry, and today, where we see evil in our nightly news, in Calgary, in Canada, in North America, in the world. It's no less poignant, the words of Ephesians 5 today. A couple of weeks ago, Pastor Joel stated that since World War II, the number of North Americans who considered the Bible the foundation of their life had fallen since the war from 65% to 4% of the population. I would put that forward as a major disintegration of the moral fabric of this country, this continent. What was the effect of having that moral fabric torn to shreds? What's been the result of labeling the Bible as outdated, judgmental, inaccurate, or frankly, irrelevant. And thus, justifying in the name of tolerance, humanism, political correctness, if you will, tossing it aside. Well, Pastor Joel also went through some pretty startling stats from Barna Research showing that over these same years, these societal issues, such as violent crime, divorce, teen suicide, and babies out of wedlock, just to name a few, have risen by as much as maybe 600 or 700% over that same time period. We need to realign ourselves, folks. We can't do it through a New Year's resolution. We need to do it through a new life resolution. Do we need more? Unfortunately, there's so much more evil. We read reports that between 200,000 and 300,000 people have died in the carnage in Syria. That there's a school shooting in the States on average 1 week. One per week since the Sandy Hook massacre in late 2012. Here's a stat that just kills me. There will have been 650 to 700,000 abortions done in the U.S. in 2015. And just as tragic, we see in the news that there's an ordained minister from the United Church of Canada, Reverend, I use that term with an asterisk, Greta Vosper, who triumphantly proclaims herself as an atheist, who says she doesn't believe in God or the Bible. Yet she still pastors a church in Toronto. Yes, my friends, these days are certainly evil. These days are evil for sure. And I don't mean to bring you down. Let's not be defeated. We need to never forget that our Lord is ultimately and eternally victorious. Just turn to Revelation. Amen. And we share that through Christ. We share that victory personally. The challenge for us, we are being called to redeem our time for Him. Because this evil world needs more Jesus. I think those stats would pretty much prove that. And we have the Great Commission to bring Him to the world. What a privilege. It's the only way that those who are chained to this evil, harboring it in their hearts, can be transformed. Man cannot manufacture that kind of change. We certainly can't do it through a New Year's resolution. Only Jesus can bring people a new life. So here's the deal. Here's what we're called to do. We need to get on it. We need to step it up. Get yourselves aligned with the Lord. That's step one. And then go shine the light of Jesus into the darkness. Redeem the time He has given us. Before we look at how we redeem our time in these evil days, let's look at what won't. I wonder if some of you are out there thinking already, if I redeem the time, my time, does this mean I don't have a life? What about my social circles? What about my hockey team? What about the friends I have online while I'm gaming? What about? Why do we make it about ourselves? What about Jesus? Okay, for just a moment, why don't we take today's passage and make it all about ourselves? Let's really look at what we get and how we are changed to be more like Jesus when we redeem our time, drawing near to our Lord and Savior. Let's fuel our time-redeeming fire, I'm sure that one will catch on too, by reflecting on the extent of the sacrifice made by Him. The more we focus on how He redeemed us, the more you want to do things that are redeeming in His sight. That seems self-evident to me. And the further you are drawn away from yourself and your desires, the result? We benefit. You have more peace. With more peace comes what? Less anxiety. You have more faith. You have more hope. You are more resilient. Here's one. You're more loving. You're more mature. But you're also more open to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Friends, you are more, not less, when you redeem your time. When we start looking at our time through this lens, He starts to illuminate the areas of our life that he wants to change here on earth and obviously for eternity. But do we do it? Nope. Not always. Here's a case in point from Friday. My daughters and I are traveling back from Nova Scotia. A 5-hour, 15-minute flight. I'd slept for maybe 3 hours the previous night because I'm cleaning up a house and packing and single parenting. I was exhausted. What did I do with the 5 hours I was trapped on the plane whose entertainment system was not working? Did I rejoice that I got to read my Bible the whole time? No show of hands, please. I'm not going to put this to a vote. No, I didn't. Did I pray? No, except maybe at liftoff and landing. No, I slept, or I tried to. Was that redeeming my time? Well, yes, it was, actually. The Lord knew exactly that I was weary, and he knows my physical limitations. Was the time redeeming when I was awake? Here's the challenge. Well, partly. And certainly more so because of the faulty TV system. I must say, outside of the 30 minutes I spent playing Temple Run with Olivia, she's pretty good. On my flight, I couldn't use the entertainment system, even though I wanted to. Then I had the bright idea I'd actually try watching a movie I'd downloaded onto my iPad. And then, for some reason, I couldn't get it to start on my iPad. Perhaps his way of getting me back in the Word and studying? Perhaps. You know, sometimes God prevents us from making choices that are not redeeming, despite our efforts. Once I got my eyes off of me and my entertainment, I turned my eyes instead to him. I chose to listen to worship music. I love worship music. And then I was prompted by the Spirit to invest a couple hours redeeming my time and prepping this sermon. Then I finished up with reading my Bible. Not bad for a sinner like me, but was I perfect? No. There's a message for us. I don't want anyone to walk away from today's service with the impression that you have to somehow be instantly perfect at only allocating time to godly things. You will end up feeling defeated. Again, the most straightest is not us. Instead, my prayer is that you walk away with this passage in your heart, and you're encouraged that no matter where you're at, if your heart is to draw closer to Jesus, if you're investing time with him, the location of your treasure will change, and thus your heart will change too. You will find yourself wanting to read your Bible, wanting to pray, wanting to study, and wanting to serve him. I guarantee you that before I got serious in my walk, my flight this week would still have been over 5 hours long. But I would have figured out a way likely to waste every minute of it, rather than redeeming maybe half of it. What prevents us from redeeming our time? Kind of a fun question, something for you to pray into in your devotional time this week. Laziness? Well, it's pretty simple. Not starting means not finishing. Excuses? I don't have enough time is the number one excuse. Well, maybe you don't. But likely you do. I challenge you to look at where you're investing your time and decide if it's redeeming. Is it aligned with your priorities? Is it aligned with his priorities? Is it honoring to God and the gifts he's given you? There's a lack of balance. Something I've said in the past. We must balance world time with word time. Time with his holy word. Time truly realigning to the truth. Maybe it's time in sin. Gossiping. Lusting. Coveting. Idle talk, idle thoughts, anger. Not only are we pouring filth all over ourselves, we're actually taking time away from him to do it. Oh, we all do it. Okay, I get it, Shaun. Now what do I do? Well, I'm going to encourage every single one of you, that happens to be a man, to redeem your time in February. Get registered for this. It's 2.5 days. It's completely redeeming. Why? Because God's in it. 2.5 days for the Lord. You can do it. We have to be aware of what gets our time. We have to be intentional. We have to intentionally take 2.5 days to do this. Our time is valuable. It's a gift from God. There's a term in the secular world that has been coined years ago. If you fail the plan, then you plan to fail. But actually may have some merit in this context. Led by the Spirit, I actually have a friend who tracked his time for a month. And then he compared where he actually put his time to his ranked list of priorities. He learned a lot, and then went ahead and started implementing changes to realign to what was important to him and to God. It was time well spent, and I'd say it was pretty redeeming. You have to be intentional with the gift God's given you. And then you have to be open and open-minded. Live your lives in a genuine manner. Be open with your brothers and sisters, with your challenges, with your priorities, with your calling, perhaps. Allow them to come alongside as a member of the body of Christ. We're all part of the body. Allow them to access the access they need in order that they may be praying for to God for you, for God to reveal things which perhaps are in your own blind spot. It may be the barrier to your growth. And more importantly, pray for his assistance, for wisdom. Acknowledge him. Ask him to direct your path in order that you may walk in his ways. Is he the big L Lord of your new life? Or for you, is he the small L Lord? The Lord of only the part of your life that you're willing and choosing to give him. Pray for increased trust and faith if you're having troubles giving him at all. Verse 17, understand the will of the Lord. What's the will of the Lord for us? There's many passages in the Bible about the will of the Lord for us. I'm going to focus on one. Our sanctification. Big fancy Christian word. It means to be set apart. Set apart for his purposes. In chapter 4 of Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians, we are shown that God's will is for us to abound in the Lord Jesus, to embrace him, walking in a manner that pleases him, in a manner which is aligned to his commandments. Our sanctification occurs as we grow closer in relationship with him, growing in our faith, our knowledge of his word, growing in our prayer life, and being more aware of the Holy Spirit's leadings in our lives. As we grow in our faith, God's will is for us to be bringing the gospel message to all corners of the world, or at least our world. It's great that Chris and Lauren are going to Tanzania. Not all of us can go to Tanzania. We can't all support each other if we're all in the mission field. That's cool. But that's part of what we are called to do. We all have corners of our own world that need the gospel message. We need to shine the light of Jesus from within our souls and into the dark corners of the world, especially in these evil days. Does that make you uncomfortable? Brothers and sisters, Christianity is not about comfort. Despite popular books to the contrary, we are not going to think our way to our best life now. The best life is never going to be now. It's going to be then, in heaven. All of the disciples believe this to the core. And this belief allowed them to put Jesus first. That's what we're called to do. And they put themselves second. Also what we're called to do. So much that the disciples suffered immeasurably for that gospel. Ostracized, imprisoned, beaten, rejected, shamed, and ultimately put to some of the most heinous deaths. Despite these physical atrocities, they walked in the ways of the Lord, circumspectly, with wisdom, and most certainly their time was redeemed immensely. Praise the Lord for them for sure, but also praise the Lord for us. God's will is for us to be active in our praise. He's chosen us to be alive at exactly this time, to be the torchbearers spreading the truth, a loving message of a new life available through Jesus Christ. A wise person pauses and seeks to find the will of the Lord is. I have certainly had a longish period over the past year and a bit, as I've sought to discern His will over my vocational path. Perhaps I'm actually getting a little bit wiser. How does one seek His will? Well, as I said, we study our Bible, we pray, we ask for His assistance. He'll give it to us. He left the Helper in the Holy Spirit for us. When do we know that we're within God's will? Well, we have peace about our decision. We have found, maybe we found supporting passages which resonate in our hearts. We just can't shake. We sometimes receive confirmation from a fellow believer when they what they say perhaps resonates with us, or maybe they have a passage that God's given them. Only a fool goes blindly through life, making decisions based on their own flesh and in their own strength. Only a fool doesn't consider the eternal effect of that choice. It's why it breaks my heart when I speak to those that are self-described agnostics or atheists. I've got some friends in Nova Scotia that I dearly love, and they are so lost, and I love them so much, and they're comfortable being agnostic. They are ignorant to the dire consequence of that choice. They are being foolish with their own soul. It is what motivates me to want to make sure that they hear of the saving grace that's only available through Jesus. I pray that it motivates you too. For the will of the Lord is what? That none should perish. All right. Let's move on. Do not be drunk with wine. Fun passage. We can have quite a bit of discussion about this one. In which is dissipation. What's the point here? Do not be drunk with wine. Do not lose self-control. Keep self-control. Self-control is, after all, a fruit of the Spirit. Don't let anything that is not of God control you and your actions, your choices, your time, your witness. Wine, in this instance, but I could just as easily say drugs, lust, greed, those who don't know God, social media, maybe that controls you, your parents, TV, your girlfriend, maybe your employer, whatever it is. If it's not of God, don't let it control you. Instead of allowing these earthly things to control you, verse 18 tells us to be filled with what? Tells us to be filled and controlled with what is of the Lord. In this case, the Holy Spirit, the Helper that Jesus sent after His ascension. It will allow you to walk in His ways if you trust and obey it. We need to live by the assurance of Ezekiel 36:27. I will put my Spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them. Notice we're not in that verse. I will put my Spirit within you. It has nothing to do with us. Because if you are filled with the Spirit, there's, by definition, no room left for the flesh. You, by default, again, walk in His ways. I guarantee you, you're going to be redeeming your time more. Have you ever met someone who you would say lives their life full of the Spirit? How many people know a person? I just said that. How many people have a person in mind? Show of hands. Quite a few. What kind of person are they? Super friendly? Super loving? Super caring? Super servants? That sounds corny, but they're pretty darn super after all. Don't we all want to have those kind of characteristics? Such a joy-filled life. That is the path to joy. And friends, it's not of us. So now that we're walking circumspectly, with wisdom, redeeming our time, and being beacons of light in these evil days, what's next? We'll bring this to a close. We rejoice. We encourage one another. We worship Him, and we are thankful. Let's look at verse 19 and 20. Verse 19a, speak to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing God's praises to one another. Rejoice in what He's done, who He is, and what He means to you. Speak out, shout out to others. When we do this, it will change how we feel and how we feel about those other people. When we're praising Him openly in community, the community draws closer together. This is what non-Christians notice about a group who's redeeming their time and praising God. That they're truly close. That's why I can make a joke about shake and greet at Mountain Springs. They actually care for each other. It's a far cry from the norm of this ever more evil and ever more self-centered world. Praise God for that. And then, we're supposed to be singing and making melody in our hearts to the Lord. Psalm 105 verse 2 says, sing to him, sing songs, psalms to him. Speak out, shout out again, but now to him. Grow in your heart the connection to him through the Holy Spirit. Rejoice, sing inwardly and outwardly, your whole body, mind, and soul. Singing to your Lord is a way to bring light into a dark feeling day, to bring hope into what seems hopeless, to bring joy into a pool of sorrow. When you sing to your Lord and open your heart, he fills it anew. And then what? We're supposed to give thanks. Verse 20. All and all. Giving thanks always for all things. When? Always. What? All things. Who? God the Father. How? In the name of Jesus Christ. Now, my friends, is you should put that on the wall. That's not a bad way to live. It's pretty simple, really. And look, you're Canadians. You have Canadian manners, for crying out loud. It should come pretty easy to say thank you. Isn't it interesting that depending on what my mind is focused on, my feelings change? When I'm focused on myself, my feelings turn to anxiety, fear, feeling of being overwhelmed. But when my mind's focused on praising him and giving him thanks, my heart is lifted. But get this, more importantly, my eyes are lifted. Instead of my head hanging down, I'm not focused on myself. I'm focused on my Savior. What a blessing. As we come to a conclusion today, let's take a look at verse 21 and this concept of submission. It'll be the topic for the next few weeks here. It's something the world rails against, just by definition. The thought of submission is being somehow less than who you're submitting to. In this verse 21, we're called to submit to one another. Again, it's not about us. It's about him and his children. We have a new life. It's not about what you have. It's not about what you think. It's about what you can do for each other. It's about learning to submit to each other as separate members of the same body of Christ, so that we can all function for the greatest effectiveness. Let's look at verse 19 and 20. Let's look at verse 21, sorry, in relation to 19 and 20. It seems pretty obvious to me that God hasn't made his first mistake ever. They're in the right order. What do we have to do? We have to sing praises outwardly and inwardly. We have to give thanks. But then, it's easier to submit to one another. Why? Because we've taken our eyes again off of us and onto him. Now, when we have a normal, very normal difference of opinion with a fellow brother or sister, if we have a petty argument with those we love, if we're wrestling with biblical counsel that we've been given, it's easier to submit, and we are given more peace. Amen. So what should be your new life resolutions? Be wise, not foolish. Redeem your time, the time God's given you. Keep self-control. Sing and praise. Encourage one another. Rejoicing as you connect with him in your heart. And say thank you. Be grateful for what he has done through the act of Jesus. Allow yourself to submit to others who have done the same. Seems like a pretty good plan for your life. It's God's plan for your new life. And thank God, it's not a pledge made on New Year's Eve, out of our own strength and from our own wisdom.